שלום רב לכולם. אנו שמחים לפתוח את הכנס השנתי הבינלאומי ה-14 של המכון למחקרי ביטחון לאומי, שנערך השנה במתכונת וירטואלית מול אלפי צופים וצופות מהארץ ומהעולם. השנה האחרונה הייתה רצופה אתגרים עבור כולנו. בין הדילמות שהתעוררו אצלנו הייתה השאלה כיצד לשמור על המסורת ולערוך את הכנס השנתי. וכאן הטכנולוגיה באה לעזרתנו. עם זאת, אי אפשר להתעלם מהשוני בין כנס זה לבין הכנס שנערך בדיוק לפני שנה באוניברסיטת תל אביב בנוכחות פיזית של כ-1,000 איש. למרות שכבר אז היו שמועות בדבר מחלה מסתורית בסין שמתפשטת במהירות, איש לא העריך שעד מהרה תתחולל ברחבי הגלובוס מגפה שתגרום משבר בריאותי, כלכלי וחברתי עמוק במדינות רבות. משבר שבצילו פעלנו לאורך השנה כולה. בהזדמנות זו, אנו רוצים להודות לכם, ידידי המכון והתורמים לו, על האמון שנתתם בעבודת המכון וההכרה מצדכם בתרומתו החשובה לביטחונה הלאומי של מדינת ישראל. אנו מצרים על כי לא נפגשנו בשנה החולפת פנים מול פנים, ומקווים כי בעתיד הנראה לעין נוכל להתראות. תודות מיוחדות למר ג'ון ג'ייקובסון, יושב ראש חבר הנאמנים הבינלאומי, ולמר פיני כהן, יושב ראש חבר הנאמנים הישראלי, שמהווים נדבך חשוב בהצלחת המכון, ואשר בשנה המאתגרת הזו סייעו למכון לשמר את בסיס התורמים ואף להרחיבו. ובנוסף בחרו להגדיל את תמיכתם האישית במכון. איחולי כנס מעניין לכולם. אני מתכבדת להזמין לשאת דברי ברכה את סר פרנק לואי, יושב ראש הוועד המנהל של המכון, שלאור חזונו והנהגתו הגיע המכון להיות המכון המוביל בארץ ואחד מ-20 מכוני המחקר המובילים בעולם בתחום הביטחון הלאומי.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm pleased to open the 14th annual conference of the INSS. It is a pleasure for me to join you, unfortunately not in person, because we all know the effects of the coronavirus. 2020 was a challenging year for the world, Israel, and of course for the INSS. I am proud to say that the INSS has risen to the challenge. During the past year, the INSS widened its scope of activity with broader view of national security. In addition to security and defense, the INSS now recognizes that economy, public health, and civic resilience are part and parcel of national security. Much of the recent work of the INSS dealt with the pandemic. Going forward, we will invest resources and effort in addressing the economic and social challenges facing the state of Israel post-pandemic era. Recently, Israel has signed normalization agreement with 4 Arab countries. The agreements will strengthen Israel and help to stabilize the region. I am proud that our institute has begun to cooperate with the institutes of these 4 countries and hope that more normalization agreement will be reached in the near future. Many people have contributed to the success of the INSS. I would like to thank all of our donors and supporters, especially Professor Ariel Porat, President of the Tel Aviv University, Amos Yadlin, Head of the Institute, Udi Dekel and Orly Hayardeni, and of course, all the researchers that have worked so well during the past year. The INSS continues to provide this important work for the State of Israel. I wish you all successful conference and Toda Raba.
תודה פרנק. אני רוצה להזמין את עמוס ידלין, ראש המכון, לשאת דברי פתיחה.
חברי הוועד המנהל של המכון, בראשות סר פרנק לואי, יושב ראש חבר הנאמנים הבינלאומי של המכון, מר ג'ון ג'קובסון, יושב ראש חבר הנאמנים הישראלי, מר פיני כהן, חברי חבר הנאמנים הבינלאומי והישראלי, אורחים ואורחות מארץ ומחול, חבריי להנהלת המכון, חוקרות וחוקרים, קהל הצופים בנו בארץ וברחבי העולם, שלום רב. אני מתכבד לפתוח את הכנס השנתי הבינלאומי, ה-14 של המכון למחקרי ביטחון לאומי. הכנס השנה שונה מכל הכנסים הקודמים, ועומד בסימנה של שנת משבר כבד ורב-ממדי לאנושות ולמדינת ישראל. משבר בריאותי, כלכלי, חברתי, משבר אמון בין אזרחים להנהגותיהם. המגפה וצעדי הנגד כפו עלינו שגרה חדשה ומשובשת. ריחוק חברתי הטיל על כולנו מגבלות קשות, ואילץ אותנו לחפש משמעות חדשה למילים ישנות, כמו מפגש, אספה או כנס. ובה בעת המשבר האיץ כניסתם של טכנולוגיות חדשות, ובזכותם אנחנו יכולים לקיים את מסורת הכנס, במתכונת עדכנית, להיפגש ברוחנו בעוד אנו רחוקים בגופנו. ה-INSS הוא מכון חקירה וחשיבה מוכוון מדיניות. המצפן היחידי שלנגד עינינו הוא קיומה, ביטחונה וסגסוגה של מדינת ישראל, שכוחה בצדקתה, כמאמר בן גוריון, והם נר לרגלינו. כאשר ישראל מסתחררת במערכות בחירות בלתי נגמרות, כאשר תהליכי קבלת החלטות הלאומית נפגעו עמוקות, כאשר הממסד הביטחוני מודר שוב ושוב מהכרעות חיוניות, כאשר השיח הציבורי מתרוצץ במרדף בין הספין האחרון לפייק ניוז שלפניו, אנו ב-INSS מקפידים להמשיך ולבסס המלצות למדיניות על מחקר מקצועי עמוק, רב-תחומי, יצירתי ומאיר נקודות עיוורון. בישראל וגם במכון למחקרי ביטחון לאומי, הסתנו השנה תשומת לב ניהולית ומחקרית לתוך הבית פנימה, מבלי להסיר את עינינו מהאיומים החיצוניים, וגם מההזדמנויות. משבר הקורונה הגיע בהפתעה, ברבור שחור, והדגים פעם נוספת את מחירם הכבד של פערי הערכות למשברים חמורים שסבירותם נראית נמוכה. המכון, שמומחיותו בחקר וערכת איומים ביטחוניים ומדיניים חיצוניים על מדינת ישראל, התארגן במהירות כמרכז חשיבה רב-תחומי, והציע ראייה מערכתית ופתרונות אסטרטגיה, מדיניות וארגון להתמודד עם המשבר. תרמנו להבנת המתרחש סביבנו, שהמשגנו את החיים בנוכחות קורונה, המלצנו להיערך לגלים הבאים, לאזן בצרכי הבריאות לדרישות הכלכלה ולנהוג מדיניות דיפרנציאלית וחכמה. הצבענו על אמון הציבור כמפתח להצלחה, ומנגד על היעדרו כמכשול למימוש מדיניות והנחיות. והדגשנו את הכורח החיוני ללמוד ולתחקר את כלל ממדי המשבר, תוך כדי התרחשותו ולהשתפר במהלכו. כל אלה עלו בפורומי החשיבה שארגן וערך המכון כבר בחודשי המשבר הראשונים, מרס ואפריל 2020. בה בעת, ולמרות שנה שקטה מאוד בגבולות, האיומים על מדינת ישראל מבחוץ לא נעלמו. עסקנו באיום האיראני על שתי זרועותיו, תוכנית הגרעין ומאמצי ההגמוניה ברחבי האזור. שני מפקדי המאמצים האיראנים האלו, הגנרלים סולימני ופחרי זדה, הורדו מהבמה השנה. אך הוקטורים האסטרטגיים של איראן מול ישראל לא נעצרו. איראן ממשיכה לפתח איומי אש מדויקת ולהפיצם לשלוחיה באזור מתימן ועד לבנון. חיזבאללה ואיראן מבטיחות תקיפות נקמה ועלולות לשגות במיסקלקולציה ולהוביל להסלמה עד כדי מלחמה רב חזיתית. גם הסוגיה הפלסטינית, סוגיית מפתח בביטחון הלאומי, נדחקה לשוליים. אך אין לשגות באשליה שהיא נעלמה. האיום של גלישה למדינה אחת דו-לאומית הוא עדיין איום קיומי על אופייה היהודי הדמוקרטי של מדינת ישראל. העולם שמסביבנו כמרקחה, ומשבר הקורונה רק מחריף מתחים ומגלה נקודות חולשה. אין רעיון מסדר המקובל על הקהילה הבינלאומית. הסדר הליברלי-דמוקרטי מאותגר על ידי סין, רוסיה, צפון קוריאה ואיראן, כל אחד בדרכה, אך גם על ידי רדיקלים אסלאמיסטים ונאו-נאצים. כולם קוראים להחלת סדר מבוסס חוקים, אך מכוונים לסט חוקים שונה לחלוטין. אנו שומעים על חידושים טכנולוגיים, אינטליגנציה מלאכותית, IoT, מחשוב קוונטי, 5G, אך מתקשים להפנים את מלוא השפעתם על חיינו בכלל ועל הביטחון הלאומי בפרט. בראש הדאגות העולמיות לא עומד הנשק הגרעיני, אלא התחממות כדור הארץ, רעב, מגפות, גלי הגירה, פופוליזם לאומי, חדשות הכזב והתרחבות הפערים בין עשירים ועניים. אלגוריתמים ברשתות החברתיות אחראים על עיצוב תפיסות הציבור והתנהגותו, לא פחות מאשר מנהיגים נבחרים. האמת עצמה, מרכז הכובד בביטחון הלאומי, נמצאת תחת התקפה בלתי פוסקת, מבית ומחוץ. היום יותר מתמיד, אנו מבינים, כי דפוסי קבלת ההחלטות, גיבוש המדיניות ומימושה, הם נכסי מפתח בביטחון הלאומי. אין מול איומי החוץ, ואין במשברים בריאותיים, חברתיים וכלכליים משולבים. חולשות, פערים וקלקולים שנתגלו בישראל בניהול משבר הקורונה, מבשרים רעות גם לגבי תחומיו המסורתיים של הביטחון הלאומי. כל הנושאים הללו ידונו בכנס השנתי ה-14, שיקיף את אתגרי הביטחון הלאומי בכל הממדים ובכל המעגלים. הרמטכ"ל רב-אלוף אביב כוכבי יסכם את השנתיים הראשונות של כהונתו. שרי החוץ של מעצמות עולמיות וכן של מדינות השלום החדשות יאירו זוויות ראייה בינלאומיות ואזוריות. נביט לעבר העשור הבא שבו תתעצב המערכת העולמית, נסתכל על המזרח התיכון שארצות הברית מנסה להתמקד בסין, בעוד רוסיה ממלאת את החלל ואיראן מסלימה ומאיימת. ובמיוחד נעמיק באתגרי הביטחון הלאומי של ישראל, ביטחוניים ומדיניים. ולבסוף נביט פנימה לחברה הישראלית, חוסנה, מורכבותה ואתגריה, בצל מערכת הבחירות הרביעית הקרבה. אסיים בנימה אישית. אני עומד בראש המכון כמעט עשור. בשנים האלה מוצב ה-INSS כמכון מחקר מוביל בארץ ובעולם. חשוב להדגיש, לא הגעתי לפסגה. עשיתי זאת ביחד עם כולכם. חוקרות וחוקרי המכון, ובראשם שותפיי לצוות המוביל. אודי, איתי, אורלי, ענת ואסף. תודה ומלוא הערכה לכולכם על האופן בו צלחנו את השנה האחרונה. תודה גם לכל התורמים וכל התומכים. כולי תקווה שנשוב וניפגש כולנו בקרוב, והפעם עם לחיצת יד וחיבוק אמיץ בשש אחרי המגפה.
תודה רבה עמוס, ועכשיו לנאומו של הרמטכ"ל רב-אלוף אביב כוכבי, שיסכם אצלנו שנתיים של כהונה. צה"ל מופקד על הגנת מדינת ישראל מפני איומים חיצוניים, ובראשם איראן וחיזבאללה. עם זאת השנה, צה"ל לקח חלק חשוב ומשמעותי גם במאבק הלאומי בנגיף הקורונה. חזונו של הרמטכ"ל מגולם בתוכנית התלת שנתית תנופה. בצל המשבר הכלכלי שמדינת ישראל נמצאת בו, הצרכים של צה"ל לא פחתו, והרמטכ"ל יחלוק עמנו הערב את האתגרים העומדים בפני הגשמת חזונו, ובאיזה תנופה הוא מיושם.
שלום לכולכם.
שלום everybody. Good evening. Good evening to you, Amos and Frank.
אני מודה על ההזמנה.
I thank you for inviting me. The INSS is a leading institute both in Israel and in the world. I follow your publications and I use them quite often. And Amos, chapeau for the way you lead the institute. With your permission, I'd like to talk about five main issues in this lecture. I'd like to describe the operative and strategic situation. I want to talk about the IDF response, and I want to focus on something very central, and that is the way where we should operate the military force in an era of a populated battlefield in urban areas. And I want to say a few words about Iran. And with your permission, I'll conclude with a few words about the challenges that face us this time. The IDF operates in six arenas in six dimensions. I want to illustrate it within 1 week during December. 1 week, that's, let's say it started on Sunday. In that day, we attacked quite extensively in a state, let's call it State A. We attacked a production site and also weapons. The next day, the Iron Dome, as part of the defense system in the Gaza Strip, it detected two rockets. The same headquarters of the Air Force, together with the Southern Command, attacked that evening in response three targeted in the Gaza Strip. One of them was a production site, very significant, that took away a lot of their capabilities. In between, we operated a commando operations, not in the first circle, and 2 days later, we attacked again in the same area, which I called Area A. At this time, we prevented the transfer of weapons from A to B. It was supposed to be operated towards the State of Israel. And in the meantime, the Central Command, every single night, about 10 arrests, some of them could have attacked in the Axis 443 or in settlements, and that entire week, defending cyber attacks together with the Shabak and defending from cyber attacks, which we are under quite often. All these activities that I described compel us to have accurate intelligence, operational force, capabilities in all the circles. But in all these activities, we have a lot of risks as well. Some of these campaigns is like flying very, very fast in a very narrow canyon. We have to make sure that soldiers are not hurt, that people who are not involved will not be hurt, and even to make sure not to harm our colleagues that are working all through the Middle East. The IDF operates at least in six arenas in six different aspects. The arenas are Syria, Lebanon, the Gaza Strip, the Central Command, the Judea and Samaria area, Iran, and other places. The aspects and the dimensions are air, sea, land, cognition and awareness, spectrum, and cyber. Cyber, in the last few years, we really enhanced our activity in the offensive side of it. You have to think about it. All in all, we're talking about an unprecedented situation that the state has to operate in six arenas, six dimensions, and that necessitates us to have a lot of things. Intelligence, it also necessitates operational capabilities, also all the time to have order of priorities and to make educated decisions, how activity in arena A can have an impact on B, positively or negatively. But all in all, we have to be aware, to be concentrated 360 degrees all the time. If this is not enough, apart from Iran, all the other arenas are such that there's no real governance there or no governance at all. Syria, of course, is a good example, but South Lebanon is another example, or even the state of Lebanon, there's partial governance. The decision makers are Hezbollah, it's not even the government. Same for other arenas, but the fact that there's no governance by a sovereign state has two negative impacts. One, there are more challenges to the IDF. And second, it takes from us part of our freedom of action, of things that we would have done if they were sovereign countries. And all that that I just described around us are at least five struggles in the Middle East between superpowers and terror organizations or even religions, in Libya, in the Mediterranean, in Lebanon, of course, Syria, in all these places. I want to take Iraq as an example. You can actually ask, why do we care about Iraq? But we do care. The fact that Iran cannot control its territory and to hold itself as a sovereign state enables the Iranians to operate the militias and to transfer weapons from Iran through Iraq to Syria and Lebanon, so that the chaos in Iraq has an impact at the end of the day on us as well. I spoke about the enemies, but I want to describe to you in a different approach what they think about us. I'm not saying it by estimate, but I know. First of all, they perceive us as having a very high intelligence capability, and they perceive themselves as infiltrated. And of course, that causes their own self-confidence in their activities and decision-making. The second thing, Israel is perceived as one that operates on a very high level all over the Middle East. As a result of that, Israel is perceived as one that can defend itself, can protect its borders and assets. And the last thing is that Israel is perceived as initiator and active. It's the one that goes to campaigns, it's the one that attacks, thwarts, and this, of course, contributes a lot to the deterrence of the state of Israel. I spoke about deterrence, and I want to talk now about the strategic situation in general. In general, you can say that the strategic situation of the state of Israel is improving. If we talk about deterrence and decisiveness, I would say that deterrence among all the nations that we have to cope with has strengthened. Deterrence is not a thing that cannot be broken. But in general, none of these countries want to initiate any attacks against us. All their activities is response, reaction to what we do. It's not things that they initiate. When they decide to do something, they tackle difficulties, and then they decide to forget this type of activity. And maybe the most important thing is that we do not identify at the moment that any of our enemies or the states around us, and there are enemy countries, is planning or wants to initiate war or a big campaign against the state of Israel. If we talk about deterrence, I would say that they're right, our enemies. Intelligence-wise, we are in many places, not in all places, but we do find ourselves in many places. And operation talking, we have freedom of action all through the Middle East. I don't take it as self-evident. The state of Israel had many decades where it didn't have such freedom of action in the Middle East. And that, of course, creates a strategic position which is much stronger. All our enemies are in a very low situation. The economy, the coronavirus, which is very badly controlled there, and very deep lack of trust and disappointment from the way their regimes or the heads of the organizations take care of it. Together with that, the state of Israel and the IDF are strengthening their alliances, the cooperation, and the superpower that we have the biggest relations, best relations, is the United States. And I tell you, this is a strategic operation which is extraordinary, both in strategy as well as operation. From one year to the other, we have more cooperation, and we come to a level of intimacy which is really high with Russia as well. It's not self-evident. We have understandings and even coordinations. Egypt and Jordan, the cooperation and tightening of the military relations are getting stronger. The normalization creates a wave against our enemies, and many of them, by the way, were isolated anyway, and now they're even more isolated. If we look at the wider scope, we can look for a moment about this part of the Middle East and to see that vis-a-vis the Shiite axis, from Iran, Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, actually, vis-a-vis that, there's a bombastic and strong regional alliance. Greece, Cyprus, Egypt, Jordan, the Gulf countries, and the state of Israel is within that alliance. This is a development unprecedented. Not only that, the Iranians themselves, they see in this development like a grip, a geographic grip from the south, but also ideological grip, or even religious one, in all aspects. And above all, I'm still under the title of strategy, the test is the defense and security. This is also the first test in which the IDF has to excel. If we judge according to this test, I think that we can say that the IDF supplied and supplies in 2020 security and safety to the state of Israel. It was one of the most tense years, but very stable, with very few casualties. And all that doesn't happen by itself. It doesn't. This is thanks to a very good intelligence, effective border defense, capabilities of attacks, thwartings, and arresting, and that can change as well. With all these successes, eventually the enemy can have a success here and there. As opposed to that, the operative situation throughout the years is becoming more and more complex. Complex enough to have an impact on strategy as well. The main change, the main development, we called it terror armies in urban populated areas. Why do we call it armies? Because of the fact that today they have tens of thousands of combatants. They have battalions or brigades or whatever. They have very regular weapons. And why terror? Because of the fact that they target very clearly their fire. They target the fact that they want attack civilians in the state of Israel, not soldiers, not the army. Also, but not only. Within that, of course, we have the trajectories and the missiles and rockets. The scope is bigger. The warheads are more, the accuracy is better, and it came to very significant dimensions. In addition to that, in the last decade, both Hezbollah and Hamas built forces that, for them, they can invade Israel at a certain day. We are doing everything possible to stop it, but this is a negative development. In addition to all that, more and more they keep very sophisticated weapons. Really, who would think that a terror organization, today we call it a terror army, will have cruise missiles or accurate rockets or cyber technology changes the world. We know that. But when technology is available, it's available also to radical Islam and fundamentalism, and when one meets the other, the result is challenging. Together with all that, what happens in the Axis in the Northern Command or Syria? We see from now, even more than now, the Axis, of course, thanks to activities that we operate throughout the year with all the security forces, but this activity did not stop, and the Iranians don't even plan to stop it, so this activity is going to continue. The war between worlds, the war against the enemy is going to continue. ISIS is not hasn't disappeared. You haven't heard the name for quite some time, but ISIS or ISIL is not disappearing, neither from Sinai or Jordan or Egypt, and definitely not from Syria. It acts differently, different forms, but ISIS is acting, and it's part of our enemies. As for the Iranians and the nuclear deal, I'll talk about it later. What about the operational response of IDF? We have four priorities. The first is preventing bases of the radical axis in the north. The second thing is a reduction of the strengthening of our enemies, focusing on strategic weapons. The third, improving their readiness to act against Iran. And the last is effective defense of the borders. IDF has four things to do: to supply defense, to prevent threats, to prepare for war and win, and to create relevant force. And I'd like to say a few words about each of these. As for defense, we are now finishing a very successful year, and the parameters are, did we prevent attacks? And the second, did we obtain stability in some of these arenas? In the Gaza Strip, that can be a good example to stabilization and security in a certain place. It didn't happen by itself. It happened in a combination of military force and civilian policy. As for military force, we wouldn't get there had we not gone through three campaigns. One was a campaign against the Islamic Jihad, where we throated or targeted, killed the leader in Gaza, but wasn't enough. We had to thwart and to target leaders and to attack. Every time we came to a decision to attack, whether it be explosive balloons or rockets, the choice was the quality targets of Hamas and the Jihad. This accumulated mass brought us to the recognition that all in all, there's no point in their activity. But I can't present it by itself. It's combined with civilian activity. We enabled them to have more trade, to have more stability, and we enabled the Qatar aid that they are now receiving. This security is not just exerting force, because security is force and brain, sticks and carrots. But these carrots, we have a condition, a very definite condition. We determined a ceiling in the civilian policy, a red line. And unless the mission is solved of returning our MIAs, we are not going to go above this line. The Gaza Strip can be in a different situation than it is today. I say to the inhabitants, to the residents of Gaza, you can be in a completely different situation as far as quality of life. But we're not going to advance beyond this line until our MIAs are returned home. We plan to insist on that in a very blatant way. And I go back to defense. We're going to improve it in intelligence, protecting the borders until the end of the summer. We're going to finish the barriers in Gaza. We'll continue the thwarting of threats. And we are now in the process of establishing smart brigades, like a smart city, changing the brigades in the Judea and Samaria area to smart brigades with technology and other advanced capabilities. We will actually succeed to thwart terror in a more effective way. And from here, I'd like to go over to the mission of prevention, which got the title of the war between wars. This war has been happening since 2013. What does it mean, war between wars? It means a preventive war. The state of Israel went on a preventive war in order to reduce the capabilities of the enemy, to thwart threats, and before war, to have them have less good conditions, and through that, perhaps, to distance the war altogether. 2020 is a year of activity. We attacked more than 5 targets in 2020, but there are many other operations that are not just attacking. There are other things. I can say cautiously that all in all, we reduced quite extensively the capabilities of our enemies to transfer weapons in the air, in land, or in sea. We reduced quite a lot of the transfer of monies that were designated for terror. We reduced some of their capabilities that were already in those countries where they act. And we are cutting methodically. We are exposing and cutting the tunnels in the Gaza Strip. I'm not talking about 5 or 6. I'm talking about much higher numbers. The war between wars is going to continue. Readiness for war. Readiness for war. We are busy with a few things. First of all, 3 kinds of warehouses for weapons. The 2 you know less. The 3rd you know very well, the ones we know. The first 2 is the target, targets. I'm talking about warehouse, quote unquote. The IDF is making an effort to increase the reservoir of targets, to concentrate them. Just yesterday, I sat on a status, as I do almost every month. The pace of creating targets in IDF grew quite extensively. We have a whole body of 250 people, administration of targets. From morning to night, what they do is to create targets in order to bring a much more significant victory when the time comes. This is the warehouse, so to speak, of targets. But in order to have an effective attack, you need weapons. And therefore, the warehouse of the weapons is also something we need, the real one. We are increasing the scope of our armaments from the rifle at the hands of a soldier to the Air Force, so that in the day when it comes, we will be able to implement all these plans. As for plans, we improved the operational plans to all the areas, and we do the utmost in order to train in very advanced methods that simulate battlefield. We train in urban areas at night. We train in combined units. It can be the Air Force with the Navy, from the not just in the higher echelons, but the real men. We invest a lot of time, more than in the past, in training the commanders, the ones who, in the end of the day, lead the victory is the commander, of the base or commander of the brigade. The professionalism of the commanders is a real asset that we are fostering in great attention. The peak this year is going to be a month of war. We're going to drill for a whole month all the systems of the IDF with great scopes in all the arenas and great loads. The last thing I want to talk regarding readiness is a very important project, which is called the regiment as Citron. What we want to do is to complete all the units of the IDF, the people who actually go into the Gaza Strip, to complete them with their weapons for day, for night, to arm them, to have more manpower, not just to complete it, but also to strengthen them, to give them interfaces of attack and other means, and also to give them the capabilities so that their action will be more effective. From here, I'd like to go to the last section of the readiness for war in a relevant way, or change. I spoke already about the change of the battlefield, and this change compels us to change as well. The IDF changes throughout the years. During 2019, we had a whole long process, very poignant, on the way that we have to change in order to be relevant and to obtain our missions and our victories. We consolidated a whole concept, and that actually is the main compass of the multi-year program momentum that we are embarking upon for the second year. According to the perception, we're talking about the same things as we did then, and of course you need the spirit of war. But because the enemy is so dispersed and so deployed, and it has rockets and missiles, we have to expose it in a wider scope and to act and destroy it in a wider scope. How do we do that? How do we expose an attack more effectively? We take the capabilities that we have in the ITF, we add to that advanced technologies and new methods of war, I'm not going to elaborate, of course, and you create a multiplication of the capabilities. That's what we did. That's what we are doing. There's a long way to go. There are still many missions, but this is the essence of all the momentum long-term multi-year plan. And I give you just five examples. Much more intelligence in real time, many more targets and armaments, many more capabilities for the end units, if it can be a regiment here and there or even a squadron of the Air Force, and upgraded system, information, digital, in order to close the fire circles on the enemy in a more effective way. In addition to that, we're in the midst of digital transformation, or in simple language, connectivity, digital, of everyone to everyone. Who is everyone to everyone? The branches, one to the other. The commands, the base of the Air Force, or any unit, any brigade, and connecting the forces on land. That the commander will talk to the tank and will talk to the headquarters of the computer system with the same capabilities, the same coordinates, and that will cause operational effectiveness. In addition to that, we continue to accept very advanced platforms, and we have a series of classified projects with the aim to jump one generation in the form of battle in a situation where, again, we expose and destroy the enemy in much wider scope. This increase of the attacking factors is the main heart of the multi-year program momentum. But in order to materialize this attacking force, we need conditions and legitimacy to exert the force. Now I'd like to talk about the paradigm that we must change. We, as the state of Israel and the whole world, we have to change in order to exert the military force in a right and moral way in the era of the urban battlefield. The change that took place in the battlefield is very deep. The enemy chose to locate itself in the urban area. It selected to put the weapons and missiles and rockets in the urban area. It ignores extensively from the international law, and the result and the example is that it wants to launch these rockets and missiles on all the cities in Israel. Moreover than that, it deployed all its systems in all the villages, no matter if it's South Lebanon, Beirut, or Gaza Strip. And therefore, it's a duty to adapt both the State of Israel and IDF and the international community to adapt the patterns of thinking and fighting and even the international law to the way that we must and should fight. What is our response to this pattern of the enemy? First of all, operational plans, and I said, first of all, strategy maneuvering, and I'm not going to elaborate, but in the heart of the plans, operatively, the ability to expose and to destroy. What is the barrier? Actually, the barrier is the population that lives there. The population that lives there lives within the targets inside the battlefield. In every second of fifth house in Lebanon is either a missile warehouse or rocket warehouse. The population lives among the army military targets. We are not going to abandon the values of the IDFs or the Jewish religion or the international law, but they were not designated only in order to prevent harming people who are not involved. The values of the IDF were designated to enable us also to defend our people, our citizens. The international law, there are two basic principles, the distinguishing and proportionate. The distinguishing, you have to distinguish between a military target and a non-military. We are going to attack military targets, but if a rocket is linked to a house, it's a military target or dual target, which has a double use, is also a military target. We're going to attack military target, not any others. And now, to the proportionality. We talk about a proportional relation between the expected military edge as a result of the attack and the damage that will happen to the population as a result of the attack. And that's the change we have to make. The word that people use in Hebrew is proportionality. And proportionality is now has the music of minimalism, of cautiousness. The concept in other languages, proportionality. It's better, although it's some of the people that also got a hue of minimalism. And nevertheless, I suggest we should adopt this concept of proportionality, and in Hebrew you can call it relativity, maybe. And now let's talk about relativity. Relativity between the damage that will happen because of our attack and the advantage. If we attack one launcher in a room in a house in Lebanon or linked to a house, a populated house, will prevent attack in an apartment house in Israel and scores of Israeli citizens. This is our obligation to attack this launcher. It's our obligation to defend the citizens of the country. And the same goes for attacking all the launchers and all the missiles that we identify. This is the requirement, this is our role, and that's our designation. Today, there's no case in the world. Think about it. Never in the world, a case like the State of Israel, which is threatened with so many rockets and missiles from Lebanon, Gaza, and Iran. And obviously, also the attempts from Syria. It is threatened with so many fronts. It's threatened where the objective is to harm citizens in the hands of terror organizations or terror armies that by definitions are trampling over the international law. This is also an opportunity or a duty perhaps to remind the citizens of Israel in a clear and honest way. One day when there'll be war, many, many missiles will fall on Israel. And we're doing everything in order to prevent that, and it's not going to be easy. But exactly vis-a-vis this threat, we are going to attack extensively, whether in open areas of the enemy or built areas or the buildings of the enemy that stores weapons. And this will prevent a real attack on the states of Israel. In other words, because of intelligence, we're going to attack military targets, which will enable us to materialize the principle of distinction, and then we can then attack in such a way that will give us a military edge. This is the only way to reduce extensively the threat of missiles and rockets on the State of Israel. And after I illustrated the military edge, let me go over to the second part of the equation and to talk about the other damages that will happen. We're talking about abiding by the international law. We're going to alert the population, whether it be in Lebanon or Gaza or anywhere else. We're going to alert and warn and caution them and enable them to leave. And I already alert now the population in Lebanon and in Gaza the moment that the war starts. Actually, the moment that the tension starts, we're going to enable you, but you have to leave the place where you are living, this place which is loaded with rockets and missiles, and you know it is.
רק בחודש ספטמבר.
Just in September, a whole warehouse of weaponry was exploded in Lebanon. In the last week, it happened in Gaza. And because these areas are flooded with rockets and missiles, they will be flooded with attacks of the IDF. And if we go back to the remnants of the damage. Anybody who leaves will not be harmed. If you decide not to leave, it's your decision. It's their decision. And today already they know that they are living within a field of rockets and missiles. Our legitimacy for a wide attack is the fact that we're going to attack military targets and the military edge that we will produce from that attack. The combination of alerting the population, good intelligence that we have, and the fact that there's no other way, this triple reason will enable us to attack severely, to reduce the threat on the home front, and all that without compromising on values and international law. With their own hands, the enemies have turned everything upside down. It's the one who deployed so many rockets and missiles among civilians, and it compels us to attack so extensively in order to reduce this threat. This is a reality that the enemy created, and it's our duty to change. Due to intelligence and cautioning the population, it's going to be a moral attack. And due to intelligence, fire, and maneuvering and lethal approach, it will be effective. The concept proportionality should change to the word in English, proportionality. It should absorb the new content, and that is that you don't only check how it impacts the way we attack, but how does it impact the way we are attacking in order to defend our own citizens. The whole concept has to change extensively among anybody who's involved, whether in Israel or in the world. The approach from now on will be of a wide scope attack of the enemy targets, no matter where they are, of course, based on intelligence and alert. We do not have any other reasonable way to take away this threat, and this is our duty. In that respect, this is a moral approach, effective, and this is what we have to do. And this is exactly the expression to the designation of the IDF as Israel Defense Force. I touched upon one of the first challenges in the first circle, but I want to talk about another challenge in the third circle, and that is Iran. Iran is first and foremost a regional and world problem. It's not the problem of the state of Israel. Iran is a state that feeds terror all over the world intensively, especially in the Middle East. And above all, there's no question. Today, nobody doubts that Iran is thriving, is willing to create its capability to become nuclear and maybe to use a nuclear bomb the moment they make a decision. If the Iran deal from 2015 would have materialized at the end of the day, Iran could have obtained a bomb because the deal did not include the limitations that will stop it at the end. To date, Iran increased the enriched material above what is allowed. It enriched to much higher levels. It developed and creates advanced centrifuges, which will enable it to storm to the creation of a bomb much quicker, maybe months or even weeks. We saw recently with the change of administration in the United States, and the Iranians said they want to go back to the former deal. I really want to say what I think. My position, I say it to all my compatriots when I meet them all over the world. Going back to the Iran deal from 2015, or even it's going to be a similar deal with a few improvements, is a bad thing. It's a wrong thing. It's bad operatively and it's bad strategically because, again, it's going to enable at the end or even before the end to enrich quantities, to develop centrifuges or even the capabilities of the weaponry and then storming towards a bomb. In strategic level is very severe because it's going to be an intolerable threat on the state of Israel, and it's going to drag a whole regional nuclear efforts. Therefore, everything that's similar to the current deal or improved one is a bad thing. It's not the right thing. We cannot allow it. Moreover, Iran of today is not Iran of 2015 when the former deal was signed. Iran today is under very heavy pressure. Economic inflation, bitterness, incitement among the population. Their trade has sunk down. Iran today has very heavy pressure. And these pressures that are thanks to the sanctions of the Americans, but these pressures have to continue in any way, no matter what happens. Anything that takes away these pressures is going to enable them to have oxygen and air, and they can drag time, and at that time they'll continue to violate the current deal. There must be a very extreme action that at the end of it there'll be no capability, not just for a bomb, but no capability to storm towards a bomb on the part of the Iranians. And in spite of everything I described and all these pressures, Iran at the end can make a decision that it is advancing towards a bomb covertly or overtly. In view of the basic analysis, I ordered the IDF to prepare a few operative plans in addition to what we have already. And we are working on these plans and we're developing them. We will develop them during the next year. Whoever decides on implementing was, of course, the government. But these plans have to be on the table, they have to be ready, and they have to be documented. To conclude, I would like to talk about two of the challenges of this time. The first one, of course, is the coronavirus. From the moment this pandemic began, the IDF said loud and clear, I am here. I am here for anything that you need. Resources, equipment, experts, management, anything. We took part in scores of areas in all the authorities. We managed the hotels. We gave food. We created a digital information system. 30,000 people in the IDF were under the stretcher of the war against coronavirus. We established the information center and the command to cut the chains of infections, and we also opened a technological incubator which has to develop means that will enable regular life even during coronavirus. I talk to quite a few of my parallels, my peers. I tell you, there is no such thing to this participation of the IDF in this effort to halt COVID-19. I must say that we shall continue. Whenever there's a possibility, an opportunity, whenever we are called, we're going to stand and say all the time, one word, here I am. In parallel to that, we had the challenge of managing the IDF with the coronavirus. Think about it. The IDF, in its essence, is anti-social distance. The army works in teams, in brigades, in the tank, in the Golani brigade. We fight together, we train together, we sleep together. Despite all that, the IDF continued to function, continued to perform all its activity, and no unit was harmed and didn't lose its capability. The second challenge is the budget. Like many other bodies in Israel, the IDF has been coping for 2 years with the challenge of budget. Such a big organization of security and defense, this is a very great challenge. But first of all, we determined the first principle that we, with our own forces, by ourselves, are going to create the resources to continue the functioning and the advancement of the IDF. We said, guns come before socks. And in fact, that's what we did. We founded a lot of resources for operational attack means and to build the force of the IDF. We closed some of the brigades and units. We closed a few bases, all that first of all, we, self-example, we're going to do everything possible. A huge sum, it's almost 3 billion shekel that we moved from one side to the other in order to participate in this effort. I am aware of the social difficulties we are living with the people. The IDF is the army of the people. But I want to tell you that the missiles and the rockets of Hamas, Hezbollah, and Iranian, the missiles and the rockets, they do not cough. They're not sick with corona and they don't have problems breathing. The missiles are not sick, but they can be launched the moment somebody on the other side will decide that this is what they want to do. We don't have any indication at the moment that our enemies have reduced significantly their strengthening. They continue. Wars can happen even if they are not planned. This experience we also have, the IDF, in the last decades. Therefore, the IDF must be strong, must be ready. The IDF must be relevant and operational and capable all the time. That's what we're dealing with. This is our duty. This is our designation. The IDF continues with operations, continues to defend, continues to train, and the IDF continues to supply safety and security. And on a personal note, you know, there's the general who comes back from war and explains that he lost because he didn't have all the means and there were a lot of gaps and difficulties. And there's another general who comes back and says, I won in spite of the fact that there were quite a lot of difficulties and didn't have a lot of means. I request from us the second approach, even if it has to do with climbing with in rocky land against the wind. I require from my men and I require for myself, on me and on them, is the mission to defend, to get ready for war, and to be victorious. That's what they're concentrating on. That's what I'm concentrating on. And if I mentioned my people, my men, I would like to conclude with them as well. In IDF, there are great people, really wonderful people in all levels, both the permanent army and in the regular army. Many people of the reserves have recruited by thousands to the effort against the coronavirus. Those people who serve work very, very hard, day in, day out. I visited this morning in a maneuver of the Givati Brigade. I want to tell you, you cannot come out of there with a different sense, a sense of military force, capability, a sense of adaptivity and high motivation for command. And I'm telling you, I am a lot in the IDF. In most of the places in the IDF, there's a good spirit, a will to remain in the army, and I cannot but appreciate, great appreciation that I have to all people who serve in the army and their families. They are part and parcel of this effort and part of the load. We are going to continue to foster them. We'll foster them first and foremost based on the significance of what they're doing, based on their own fulfillment and their national fulfillment. But I want to say one more thing. In order to attack in arena A and to defend in arena B and to storm in arena 3, which is the third circle, and all that within 24 hours, you want the best commanders, the best men, the people of Israel want the best men and the best commanders. The state of Israel wants the best soldiers, the best commanders. We are there anyway. We are doing it out of a sense of satisfaction, a sense of privilege, and a sense of designation. That's the way everybody feels, and I am at the head of all that. Thank you very much.
תודה רבה לרמטכ"ל על הרצאה מרתקת. למרות הקשיים והאתגרים, חבר הנאמנים הישראלי של המכון הצליח גם בשנה זו להתגייס למען ה-INSS. הרבה בזכות פועלו המשמעותי של יושב ראש חבר הנאמנים הישראלי, פיני כהן, שייסד את חבר הנאמנים והיה המנוע להצלחתו. אני שמחה להזמין את פיני, שותף וידיד, לשאת את ברכתו.
יושב ראש הוועד המנהל של המכון, סר פרנק לוי, חברי הוועד המנהל של המכון, חברי חבר הנאמנים הישראלי, ראש המכון, האלוף במילואים עמוס ידלין, חברי הנהלת המכון וחוקריו, ידידי ותומכי המכון, הצופים בנו בשידור ערב הפתיחה של הכנס השנתי של המכון, ערב טוב וברוכים הבאים. בשם חבר הנאמנים הישראלי של המכון למחקרי ביטחון לאומי, אני נרגש ושמח לברך אתכם בפתחו של הכנס השנתי ה-14 של המכון. חבר הנאמנים הישראלי הוקם לפני 7 שנים, בשיתוף פעולה עם סגנית ראש המכון, הגברת אורלי הירדני. יחד הצלחנו להקים ולבסס גוף חזק המונה עשרות חברים, שמכירים בתרומתו הייחודית של המכון לשיח הציבורי בסוגיות שעל סדר היום האסטרטגי של מדינת ישראל ובהשפעתו על קבלת החלטות בצמרת המדינית והביטחונית בארצנו. במשלי י' פסוק י' נאמר, באין תחבולות יפול עם ותשועה ברוב יועץ. גם בישראל הסתייעות בגופים מייעצים ובחשיבה מחוץ לקופסה הם תנאי לשימור עוצמתה של המדינה ויכולת העמידות שלה בעיתות משבר. כאיש עסקים אני רואה במכון ארגון שהחזון שלו הוא השפעה מוכוונת מדיניות לשם הבטחת עתידה של מדינת ישראל. ואכן, המכון מיצב את עצמו בשנים האחרונות כגוף מחקרי בלתי תלוי, איכותי וחדשני. הייתה זו שנה בו התמודד המכון עם אתגרים בלתי צפויים, שמקורם במשבר הקורונה שיקה בהפתעה את האנושות כולה. בעיצומו של משבר פוליטי מתמשך, נקלעה המדינה למשבר בריאותי, כלכלי וחברתי, הקשה ביותר מאז מלחמת יום הכיפורים. גם בתקופה מורכבת זו, לצד העיסוק המסורתי בסוגיות מדיניות חוץ וביטחון, קידם המכון חשיבה מחקרית עצמאית ומעמיקה, בדגש על התמודדות עם המגפה והשלכותיה. וזאת, כדי לתרום לגיבוש מדיניות שקולה ויעילה של מקבלי ההחלטות במדינה. המכון רתם את יכולותיו האנליטיות לניתוחים מערכתיים ואסטרטגיים, לפיתוח ידע חדש שאפשר למכון להיות כל שפוי ומקצועי בשיח הציבורי. המלצות המכון שהתבססו על חשיבה ודיונים עם טובי מומחי הרפואה והכלכלה בארץ הועברו למועצה לביטחון לאומי, למשרדי הממשלה ולציבור. בראייה ארוכת טווח הקים המכון בראשות הרמטכ"ל לשעבר רב אלוף גדי איזנקוט, שעסק בהפיכת המשבר להזדמנויות בכל היבטי המדיניות הציבורית והביטחון הלאומי. בפרוס שנת 2021, המכון ראוי לכל הערכה. למרות האתגרים, כבדי המשקל שהמכון ניצב בפניהם, נשמר היקף פעילותו הענפה של המכון, ואף נרשמה הרחבה של הפעילות בתחומים שהתברר שיש להעמיק בהם. כמו למשל, סוגיית האיום האיראני, המלחמה הצפויה בגבולנו הצפוני, והתחרות הגלובלית בין מעצמות העל, סין וארצות הברית. אנו, תומכי המכון, חשים אמון רב וגאווה באיכות המכון וחשיבותו, ונרתמנו להגדיל את תרומתנו לעשייה המקצועית והמשמעותית במכון. המכון נערך לאתגרי השנה הבאה, בראשם יציאה והתאוששות ממשבר הקורונה, המשך ההתקדמות האיראנית לגרעין, פרויקט הדיוק של חיזבאללה, וביסוס יחסי עבודה ואמון עם הממשל הדמוקרטי הנכנס בארצות הברית. קהל נכבד, במבט של 7 שנים לאחור, אני מעיד כי השגנו את היעד. מיצוב המכון כגוף מחקרי בלתי תלוי, מוכוון מדיניות ובעל השפעה ציבורית וממסדית. הנרי קיסינג'ר כתב פעם שאין למנהיגים זמן רב לחשוב. הם לכודים בקרב האינסופי שהדחוף בו תמיד מקדים את החשוב. ובהשלכה אלינו, זהו בדיוק תפקידו של המכון. לשמור על ראייה רחבה ולהזכיר כל העת להנהגה ולציבור מה באמת חשוב. ובמבחן התוצאה, לפי דירוג עולמי של מכוני חשיבה, המכון מדורג במקום הראשון בישראל ובמזרח התיכון, ובמקום ה-14 בעולם כולו בתחום מכוני מחקר של ביטחון לאומי. השנה, בשונה משנים עברו, אנו מקיימים את הכנס בצורה וירטואלית, ומכירותי עם המכון והנהלתו, אין לי ספק שגם מגבלה זו לא תמנע מאיתנו את החוויה המיוחדת של כנס שנתי, איכותי, מעמיק ומלמד. שיהיה לכולנו כנס פורה ומעניין. תודה רבה.
תודה פיני. השנה הזו עומדת בסימן הסכמי אברהם, שהביאו עמם תקוות גדולות למזרח התיכון. ה-INSS ומכוני המחקר המובילים, האטלנטיק קונסיל מארצות הברית וה-Emirates Policy Center, חתמו על הסכם שותפות אסטרטגית לקידום היחסים בין איחוד האמירויות לישראל. שיתוף הפעולה הותנה בביקור משלחת של המכון באבו דאבי, שכלל מפגש עם שר החוץ דוקטור אנואר גרגש ודיאלוג אסטרטגי פורה וגלוי. חודש לאחר מכן, ראש המכון הוזמן לביקור בבחרן עם שר החוץ דוקטור עבדולטיף בן ראיד אזייני והשתתף בוועידה השנתית של ה-IISS במנמה. בשנה הקרובה, קבוצות עבודה משותפות של מכוני המחקר יפרסמו מחקרים מוכווני המלצות למדיניות ויערכו סמינרים ותדריכים משותפים. אנו מודים לשר החוץ של האמירויות על שבחר לערוך את הופעתו הראשונה לקהל הישראלי, ביחד עם עמיתו, שר החוץ גבי אשכנזי, מעל במת ה-INSS. אני שמחה להזמין את ראש המכון, עמוס ידלין, שינחה מפגש ראשוני וייחודי זה.
שלום לכל הצופים בנו מאוסטרליה הרחוקה ועד ליבשת אמריקה. לפני שהצטרפו אלינו השרים הנכבדים ממדינות השלום החדשות מהמפרץ הערבי, אני שמח לארח את חברי הטוב, שר החוץ שלנו, רב אלוף במילואים גבי אשכנזי. גבי ואני שירתנו יחד במטה הכללי של צה"ל לפני יותר מ10 שנים. יחד התמודדנו עם 2 תוכניות גרעין עוינות במדינות אויב. את הסורית סיכלנו. ומול האיראנית הכנו יחד אופציה צבאית שאולי בזכות היותה ריאלית ואמינה, היא הובילה לעצירה זמנית של תוכנית הגרעין האיראנית בהסכם הגרעין מ-2015. Fast forward 6 שנים. גבי, אנחנו שוב מול הדילמה, כיצד להתמודד עם תוכנית הגרעין האיראנית. 2 שאלות הייתי רוצה לברר איתך, לאור ניסיונך כרמטכ"ל ולאור תפקיד המפתח של שר החוץ שאתה ממלא היום. באיזה דרגת חומרה אתה רואה את האיום האיראני בכלל ואת האיום הגרעיני בפרט?
קודם כל תודה על ההזמנה, הזדמנות לברך את המכון לא רק על הכנס, אלא התרומה שלו למחשבה, לשיח ולתרומה בתחום הביטחון הלאומי. אין ספק שתחת הנהגתך המכון באמת אולי השחקן הכי מרכזי שהוא לא ממשלתי, ועל כך אני מברך. אני חושב שאיראן מייצגת, כשמסתכלים על המציאות האסטרטגית של מדינת ישראל, מייצגת את האיום המרכזי והעיקרי למדינת ישראל, משום שאיראן מקפלת בתוכה בעצם יותר מאיום אחד. האיום המסוכן ביותר, שהוא, אם הוא יתממש, הוא איום קיומי למדינת ישראל, איראן גרעינית, ועלינו לעשות כל מאמץ בכדי למנוע מאיראן להיות גרעינית, ואיראן חותרת לשם. האיום השני הוא כמובן כל תמיכתה בארגונים כמו חמאס, כמו חיזבאללה כמובן, והפצה של טרור, נשק, טכנולוגיה, טילים מתקדמת. לכן אין לי ספק שאיראן צריכה להיות, ואני חושב שהיא כזאת, כך היא גם מוגדרת, במקום הראשון, בכל מה שקשור לביטחון הלאומי של מדינת ישראל.
אנחנו בשנה האחרונה רואים שלמרות המקסימום לחץ, אותה מדיניות מקסימום לחץ של ממשל טראמפ, האיראנים ממשיכים להתקדם לעבר הגרעין. ועכשיו שנכנס ממשל ביידן, השאלה מה נכון שתעשה ישראל? מה המדיניות שאנחנו צריכים לאמץ?
אני חושב שהמדיניות שלנו צריכה לעמוד על שלוש רגליים. הרגל הראשונה צריכה להיות דיאלוג מקצועי, אינטימי. עם הגדולה בידידות שלנו. ובחדר הזה, שנשב איתם, נצטרך להגדיר את האינטרסים הישראלים, את סדר העדיפויות הישראלית, הדאגות הישראליות, ולהגיע להבנה עם ארצות הברית, עם הממשל החדש. אני שמח שהממשל החדש כבר אמר, מי שהקשיב לשימועים ולהתבטאויות, שהוא יתייעץ עם ישראל ועם מדינות אחרות באזור, לפני ש... הוא יגיע להסכם, איזה סוג של הסכם וכו'. הדבר השני, עמוס, אני חושב שאנחנו שנינו מבינים, אולי צריך להסביר לצופים, אנחנו צריכים במקביל לשמור אופציה צבאית אמינה על השולחן. שנינו הרי יודעים, למשל, באיום הסירוי, מה הייתה העדפה של מדינת ישראל, שמי יטפל בזה. אנחנו ציפינו שהאמריקאים יטפלו בזה, כזכור לך.
לא אנחנו.
לא אנחנו, אחרים, הממשלה. ראש הממשלה ציפה שהאמריקאים יטפלו בזה. וזה היה אז ממשל ידידותי בראשותו של הנשיא בוש. וראינו בסוף מה קרה. היום, אחרי שזה קרה, כולם יכולים להגיד מה שרוצים, אנחנו זוכרים את זה. לכן אני בוגר האסכולה שמדינת ישראל בנושאים של איום קיומי צריכה לסמוך על עצמה. כמובן, לנסות לגייס את הידידות, אבל ללא אופציה כזאת על השולחן, יהיה קשה להגיע להישג. והדבר השלישי, אנחנו צריכים לשכנע גם את ארצות הברית שאיראן גרעינית ואיראן עם חתירתה להגמוניה אזורית היא איום על היציבות ועל הביטחון לא רק של מדינת ישראל, על האזור כולו. ובמובן הזה אני חושב שההתפתחויות האחרונות של הסכמי השלום והנורמליזציה מגבירות במידה מסוימת את הקול האזורי, את המשקל של האזור, כשאנחנו נבוא לדבר עם הממשל החדש. בשום אופן לא הייתי ממליץ לעשות איזושהי מדיניות לאומתית בתקשורת וכולי. אנחנו צריכים להיות מסוגלים...
לאומתית מול האמריקאים.
מול האמריקאים. אנחנו צריכים להיות מסוגלים למצות קודם כל את האפשרות להגיע בדיאלוג, בשיח מקצועי, אמיתי, שקוף, בתוך החדר, ולחתור למצב שהדאגות הישראליות והמרכזית שבהן, אם צריך לתעדף, זה למנוע ולהרחיק את איראן ככל שניתן מההגעה ליכולת גרעינית.
לגבי אורחינו שתכף הצטרפו, אתה רואה אותם יחד באים איתנו לשיח עם האמריקאים, או גם עוזרים לנו בנקודה השנייה שדיברת עליה בנושא האופציה הצבאית?
תראה, אני חושב, בהתבסס על השיחות שיש לי גם עם ידידי איחוד האמירויות, שייח' עבדאללה בן זייד, וגם עם דוקטור עבדלטיף, שר החוץ של בחרין, אין לי ספק שהם מודאגים מאוד מהחתרנות ומהאיום האיראני. אני חושב שבכל מה שקשור לכל משותף, או להיות על אותו דף עם מדיניות קוהרנטית, אנחנו נהיה שם. האם הדברים יתרגמו מחר בבוקר לאופציה צבאית? אני חושב שזה קצת מוקדם מדי. אני כן מעודד מהעובדה שהממשל האמריקאי החליט להעביר את צה"ל לסנטקום. אני חושב, גם אתה יודע שזה המקום הטבעי אולי וההגיוני שישראל צריכה להיות בו, צה"ל צריך להיות בו, אני שמח שזה קרה. ומהניסיון שלנו, הדברים יכולים להוליד כל מיני שיתופי פעולה, בוודאי שיתופי פעולה מודיעיניים ואחרים, על מנת להתמודד עם איומים אזוריים. אני חושב שזה קצת מוקדם לכך, עדיין.
יפה, אז בוא נחזור אליך. ידידי גבי אשכנזי, אתה מסכם עוד מעט 8 חודשים כשר החוץ, אני מעריך שזה אולי יתארך לשנה. מה מצאת במשרד החוץ, שהיה כנראה משרד שהוזז קצת הצידה בשנים האחרונות? מה תשאיר כמורשת כאשר תצא לפסק הזמן שלך?
תראה, זה לא סוד שמשרד החוץ עבר תקופה מאוד קשה בשנים האחרונות, בכל מה שקשור למרכזיות שלו בתהליך קבלת ההחלטות, בתכלול מדיניות החוץ, אפילו בנושאים כמו משאבים ודברים אחרים. מצאתי אנשים מצוינים, יוצאים מן הכלל, מקצוענים, אנשים שרואים שליחות בשירות החוץ. יחד עם זה, אנשים עם מורל נמוך, אנשים שנפגעו מהיחס להם. אני חושב שאחרי שעשינו תוכנית איך להחזיר את משרד החוץ למקום הראוי לו, אנחנו באמת נמצאים במקום אחר, החזרנו גם סמכויות, גם משאבים. משרד החוץ הוא חלק מרכזי בכל מה שקשור עכשיו לביסוס הסכמי השלום. אני שמח שהדירקטיבה למימוש מהיר ומלא של הסכמי השלום עם מדינות המפרץ קורית. אנחנו עכשיו כבר בדרך לבנות שגרוריות, אנחנו עסוקים בניסוח של למעלה מ-40 הסכמים, שהם התשתית בסוף ליחסים בין המדינות. מהסכמי תיירות, ויזות, סחר, חקלאות, טכנולוגיות, השקעות, מיסוי וכיוצא באלה דברים, על מנת להנגיש באמת את הפירות של ההסכם הזה. ואני שמח ומאוד מאושר מזה שיש פשוט התרגשות. תראה, למעלה מ-70,000 ישראלים כבר ביקרו במפרץ, ולולא הקורונה היה יותר. למעלה מ-1,000 חברות ישראליות כבר נמצאות בצורה כזאת או אחרת של התקשרויות עם חברות במפרץ. לי אין ספק שעם כל החשיבות האסטרטגית של השלום, וזה מאוד חשוב, השלום עם מצרים וירדן, השלום הזה יהיה שונה. הוא יהיה שלום בין אנשים, שלום בין... הוא יהיה שלום חם, כמו שאנחנו קוראים לו. אני מזהה בעיקר מומנטום חיובי, רצון להתקדם, גם בצד של הממסד הפוליטי, וגם בצד של האזרחים. אנשים רוצים לבוא לבקר, אנשים רוצים לנסוע לשם, אנשים רוצים לממש הזדמנויות, ואני חושב שזה דבר שהוא מצוין למדינת ישראל. הוא משפר גם את הביטחון הלאומי שלנו, גם תורם ליציבות באזור, ואני חושב שבמידה מסוימת זה תהליך היסטורי, שאתה יודע, אנחנו בוגרי יום כיפור, זה תהליך שבעצם די מפוגג את הסכסוך הגדול שהיה לנו, הערבי-ישראלי.
תודה גבי, מעוטטים לי כבר ששני העמיתים שלך ממדינות המפרץ על הקו. אני חייב להגיד שנפגשתי עם שניהם בראשות משלחת של ה-INSS, הם ערכו אותנו, זה חלק מהשלום החם, הזמנתי אותם לכנס הזה, הם הבטיחו לבוא אם תיגמר הקורונה, היא לא נגמרה, אבל אנחנו נהיה איתם וירטואלית מיד. תודה רבה גבי.
זה עוד סימן לשינוי. אם היו אומרים לך לפני שנה שאתה תעשה את הפאנל השנתי, את הכנס השנתי של ה-INSS עם שרי חוץ מהמפרץ, היית סקפטי. כן, שם עוד.
This panel discussion, which I have the honor to moderate, is an excellent illustration of what we sometimes hear, what a difference a year makes, in two aspects. First, of course, is the fact that the unanticipated global pandemic means we are meeting in a virtual space instead of in person in Tel Aviv. And second, my guest in this session reflect tremendous changes that have taken place in the region this past year, when United Arab Emirates and Bahrain became the first Arab states to normalize relations with Israel in over a quarter century. Tonight's session will reflect on the significant development surrounding normalization agreements and consider a number of opportunities and challenges that await us in the near future. It is my privilege to introduce our distinguished speakers. His Excellency, Foreign Minister of Bahrain, Dr. Abdulatif bin Rashid Al Zayani. His Excellency, Minister of State for Foreign Affairs of the United Arab Emirates, Dr. Anwar Muhammad Gargash. And of course, Foreign Minister of Israel, my friend, General Gabi Ashkenazi. The format for this evening's conversation is that our guest from the Arab states will offer an opening remarks, followed by question and answer session. I would like to invite the Foreign Minister of Bahrain, His Excellency, Dr. Abdulatif bin Rashid Al Zayani, to deliver his opening remarks. But first, let me tell our audience a little bit about your distinguished career. Prior to assuming his role as Minister of Foreign Affairs in February 2020, Dr. Al Zayani was the Secretary General of the Gulf Cooperation Council, GCC. Before that, he had a decorated career in the Bahraini security establishment, where he served in a senior leadership roles, including Deputy Chief of Staff for Operations, as well as Chief of Public Security, and he is retired with the rank of Lieutenant General in 2010. Your Excellency, please.
Thank you, General Yedlin. I'm delighted to join you for this session of the INSS Annual Conference. And thank you again, General Yedlin, for the invitation to be part of this discussion. I am genuinely looking forward to exchanging views and insights with Minister Gargash and Minister Ashkenazi on the consequences and implications of the Abraham Accords we signed last September. May I start by underlining how, for Bahrain, the Abraham Accords represent a natural progression based both on our long-standing culture of openness, tolerance, and dialogue, and also the recent tangible steps we have taken. For example, the Kingdom of Bahrain Declaration on Religious Tolerance of 2017. Our hosting of the Peace to Prosperity Workshop in 2019. And last year's MOU between the King Hamad Global Center for Peaceful Coexistence and the US State Department's Office of the Special Envoy to Monitor and Combat Anti-Semitism. All of these reaffirm Bahrain's outlook and approach and ensure that, alongside the UAE and Israel, we are moving quickly to seize the opportunities ahead. Already, we have seen the three countries moving quickly to go beyond just establishing diplomatic relations and creating a broad and deep cooperation that rapidly delivers tangible benefits for all sides. And I think this has to be the right way forward, both because of the immediate positive impacts it can have on all our countries, but also as a beacon for others, showing what can be achieved with goodwill and good faith on all sides. By doing so, we have the best chance of encouraging others to become involved, as we have already seen with Morocco and Sudan. Moving ahead, I am confident that this process of broadening and deepening our cooperation will continue, and that we will quickly and clearly be able to demonstrate that this has achieved both for our countries and for the region as a whole. Of course, delivering on the many agreements and MOUs signed will be important. But from what I have seen, here too, I am optimistic that words are effectively being translated into practice. From there, my hope and expectation is that the process will start to generate its own momentum. While I do not and cannot speak for anyone else, I would anticipate that more countries will engage and that a web of genuine cooperation will gradually spread across the Middle East, bringing true and lasting peace, security, and prosperity for its peoples. And the momentum will also, I hope, be translated into renewed progress towards resolving the Palestinian-Israeli conflict on the basis of a two-state solution. In addition to building regional trust, the cooperation process set in motion with the Abraham Accords creates a clear motivation on all sides to renew efforts to reach an acceptable outcome and a strong disincentive against any steps which might impede or set back the process. Of course, there will always be some parties who will never be convinced and who will do all they can to attack and undermine our cooperation using outright falsehoods and the language of hate and division. Our best response, I believe, is twofold. First, to rally our international allies and supporters to our side in advocating for what we are doing. And secondly, to be very clear and very public about the motivation and agendas of those attacking us. Distinguished participants, for the foreseeable future, the Middle East will be a key area of international interest and concern. And the United States will continue to play an important role in its security and stability. I know that another session of this conference will dive more deeply into what the new U.S. administration might mean for our region. But I would also like briefly to offer some thoughts on how I see it impacting the Abraham Accords. First and foremost, I would anticipate continued U.S. backing for what we are doing. Regardless of politics or personalities, there is no doubt that the prospect of better relations among the states of the Middle East is unquestionably in the American interest and a central plank towards achieving many U.S. regional priorities. There is more than sufficient regional experience in the new administration for this to be well understood. But beyond this, I see clear benefits to our countries addressing the new administration with one voice on issues where we share concerns. Primarily, but not exclusively, this means our concerns on Iran, its nuclear and missile programs, and its malign influence on the region more generally. Addressing these pressing issues in a way that fully meets the legitimate concerns of regional states is essential to achieving lasting security and stability in the Middle East. If we can make clear that these concerns are not those of an individual nation, but are deep and widespread across the region, and if we are able to do so from a clear common position, then I believe that we will have much more impact in conveying the region's views to our American allies. So this is one more positive effect of working together, and one I hope will bring early and positive results. Distinguished participants, I hope that these brief comments have given at least a broad overview of how I see us moving forward, having established diplomatic relations, and how this might affect our countries, the region, and its peoples in the coming months and years. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that, Dr. Zayani. I think a well-crafted diplomacy and analysis of where we're standing. Thank you for that. And now I would like to invite His Excellency, Dr. Gargash, to speak. Here is a highlights of Dr. Gargash's bio. Dr. Anwar Muhammad Gargash is a member of the Federal Cabinet of United Arab Emirates and has served as Minister of State for Foreign Affairs since 2008. In addition to his ministerial position, Dr. Gargash was chairman of the National Election Committee. He is the chairman of National Committee for Combat Human Trafficking, member of Board of Trustees of the Emirates Diplomatic Academy, and many more important positions. Your Excellency, Mr. Gargash, please.
Thank you, General Yadin, and thank you to the INSS for hosting us. It is also good to be together with Minister Kavi Ashkenazi and Minister Abdelatif Azayani. It's barely been 5 months since we announced the Abrahamic Accords, and so much has happened already. Together, we have broken the perception that change in the region is impossible. Peace and dialogue are our tools as we move forward. At the regional level, it's important that we establish a new paradigm of cooperation geared towards a prosperous future for the entire region. Last year was a difficult year for the Middle East, as it was for the entire world. There are still many challenges to overcome, but we see that the new wave of dialogue and reconciliation is taking hold now in the Middle East. Even though the difficulties of the pandemic, even through the difficulties of the pandemic, we have seen the energy and enthusiasm among the young people of the region for a new way and a new future. The UAE-Israel opening has been a welcome and long overdue catalyst for still more change. We look forward to establishing a fruitful bilateral relationship with Israel and seek that the Abrahamic Accords will facilitate our ability to help and support international communities' joint efforts to establish a two-state solution and an independent, viable Palestinian state. The Abrahamic Accords should also prioritize tangible goals in order to ensure prosperous and mutually beneficial economic and investment opportunities. The traditional emphasis on politics should be replaced with a clear sense of the ability of political agreements and initiatives to impact and improve economic prospects and indeed the lives of ordinary people. We seek to ensure that the Abrahamic Accords are seen as a catalyst for business and investment. This is all very positive, and we still see more hopeful signs. With President Biden taking office, many anticipate a more active American role in the Middle East. In our view, robust American engagement and leadership is most welcome and positive. There's a renewed commitment and possibilities for diplomatic progress in the region. And frankly, after decades of conflict, this is the only way forward. From our perspective, Iran's nefarious activities in the region must be addressed through American leadership and with international support and regional engagement. Diplomacy and de-escalation are our priorities, and any rational approach must take into account Iran's ballistic missiles and its support for instability in many Arab countries. It is our desire to see long-term solutions through diplomatic engagement that can assure all of us with regard to the forward direction for the entire area. In this context, the UAE will continue to work hard to consolidate its agenda of tolerance as a counterweight to messages of extremism. We believe that the civilizational role of the Abrahamic Accords must not be overlooked or underestimated, for we can disagree about politics, but we must accept each other and work together to ensure a long-lasting regional stability and prosperity. No country should be exempted from this vision, including Israel and the Palestinians.
Thank you, Dr. Gargash. And I want to take this opportunity to thank both of you again for hosting the INSS in Abu Dhabi and in Manama. And now the Foreign Minister of Israel, General Ashkenazi, who doesn't need introduction in Israel, but for our audience abroad, I want to introduce him. Lieutenant General retired Gabi Ashkenazi was sworn as Israel's Minister of Foreign Affairs in May 2020. Before that, he was the 19th Chief of Staff of the Israel Defense Forces. Throughout his long and distinguished career, Foreign Minister Ashkenazi served in many senior capacities, including head of the Northern Command and as Director General of the Ministry of Defense. And now I would like to start our discussion, and let me address you with two questions to the three of you. The first one is, why now? What enabled the peace breakthrough with the Emirates and Bahrain that was not possible in previous year? Gabi, please.
Well, thank you very much, Amos, for hosting me. It's an honor to be with our colleague from Bahrain and the UAE, not for the first time, I must say, and it's a pleasure. Well, why now? I think it's several reasons. I think not in the order, but the first one is the U.S. administration, the President Trump and his dedicated team, and their efforts to promote stability, peace, prosperity in the region. Secondly, the bold decision taken by the leaders, mainly from the UAE, the Bahrainis, and all the leaders involved. Thirdly, I think when it was clear that annexation was, I would say, counterproductive, and it was moved from the table, removed from the table, it's open the door for normalization. And I think another point, it's the which was able enable us, all of us, to, as my colleague said, break the old paradigm, is the growing understanding that this region has suffered so many conflicts, and now is time to change this circle, vicious circle of violence, with the growing concern with those who are attacking the camp of security, tolerance, prosperity, and peace. Mainly Iran, as mentioned in the opening remark. I think it's no secret that we are on the same page when it's come to Iran. We are, all of us, and I think most of the region, are concerned with the Iranian intention to have a nuclear capability, with the Iranian intention, an Iranian attempt to increase its hegemony in the region using Malayan activities, supporting proxies, supporting terror, etc., etc. And I think it's very important to engage, and I'm very happy and optimistic to continue to explore and to promote this with our new friends from the region. So I think all of that, maybe others, and I think young generation are expecting to, you know, to have a new horizon. And and I'm very moved by the excitement and enthusiasm that I see from both sides to this opening. So I think it's a combination of reasons.
Thank you, Gabi. Mr. Gargash, how do you see it from Abu Dhabi?
Well, I
why now?
I have to agree with His Excellency Gabi Ashkenazi's assessment. I mean, it is really a combination of things, and clearly also the American role as a conduit for this process was very important. But let me just add our, I think our sort of local flavor to it. I mean, from our perspective, it was important that the cycle of really not going anywhere be broken. I think this was important. And I think over 40, 50 years of disengagement with Israel, we can clearly see that this is not really the best approach. That we have tried disengagement, and disengagement was really counterproductive. But we believe also that it was obvious that engagement was the way forward.
Thank you. From Bahrain, why now?
Well, probably it's difficult to add more. Both the ministers have really covered all the stars that my brother Dr. Anwar have indicated. They are really, they came into alignment, the stars, and there are many factors. But above all, I would like to really emphasize the importance of the boldness that our leaders had, especially His Majesty King Hamad and His Royal Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed. And they really seized the opportunity, and being able to recognize the opportunity and seize it at the right time. For Bahrain, as I have indicated in my remarks, it continues and builds upon our principles of tolerance and openness, and also our willingness to reach out the hand of cooperation and dialogue.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And in Israel, we see the peace with the United Arab Emirates and Bahrain as a chance for a new benchmark for different peace, a warm peace. And now when the celebrations are over, how we feed the expectations that peace will be a different peace, a warm peace? We'll take it in a different order, in the opposite order. So, Abdul Latif, please.
The warm peace will not only just be the absence of conflict, but a genuine, really, cooperation in which we exchange knowledge, commerce, trade, expertise, and also enhance people to people, and enhance and benefit from the human values that really unite us as peoples, as nations, and as countries. I think war and peace between the peoples is sometimes that has to be cultivated and looked after. We must have the patience and provide the environment so that societal level relations evolve naturally. I think these are the most fundamental requirement for achieving and maintaining a warm peace. The intent is to have a warm peace, but I think it's incumbent on us to provide that environment to ensure that it is achieved and it is maintained and sustained through the people, from the people to the people.
Thank you very much. Dr. Gargash, please.
Clearly, everything that we have been doing from day one on both sides is to try and build the basis of a normal relationship. So a relationship that has really being built from scratch. So clearly the various agreements that are cornerstones of any relations that will allow people to travel, work, invest, that will allow companies to cooperate, all these things were from the get-go were clear directives that we had in building this relationship. At the same time, I think the influx of travelers on both sides is very indicative of people wanting to understand the other, people wanting to see the other side. And I expect that, barring COVID, this is something that we will clearly see. I think the UAE's intention is very, very clear. And that intention is to think strategically about peace with Israel and to work on areas of differences, which are mostly political, and to play a role also in trying to help resolve some of these differences. But I think from the start, the economic opportunities, the investment part, the travel part, the various elements of a people-to-people relationship have always been present in our approach.
Thank you. Gabi, please.
Well, I think it's a very important question. On the one hand, on the other hand, I'm very optimistic. I think it's our commitment on the governmental level to develop the trust, the respect, and to lay down the foundation for full scope of relationship. We must give the people the proof that there are fruits for this declaration, rhetoric, and agreement. They must enjoy the fruit of peace. And I'm very optimistic. I, based on my relationship with both our distinguished guests, I see a full commitment on the other side to articulate all the agreements on various fields, to facilitate to business, people to people, all the interaction. I think it's end of the day, it's story about people. People from both countries who want to have and to share a different future. It might be very simple, but they want to see a change. They want a new horizon. They want a new market. They want new friends. And I think it's our commitment and our responsibility to address it and to facilitate this desires.
Thank you, Gabi. I'm going with your optimism and asking Dr. Garagash, who is next? Who is joining the process?
Well, again, I would say the UAE has been very, very, careful and circumspect about these decisions because these are sovereign decisions. And I think each state has its own timeline, its own agenda, its own view of its interests. And as we respect other states, respecting our sovereign decisions, I think we also extend that to them. Having said that, I think the more strategic and successful we are with the Abrahamic Accords, the more attractive it will be. So if we think really strategically about this accord, if people can see that these accords are basically helping stability and prosperity in the region and helping the prospects for reconciliation in the region, for resolving issues, for creating more opportunities. I think this sort of strategic outlook will actually make these accords much more attractive. So I think throughout, we've always emphasized that this is not short-term tactical thinking. It's in fact long-term strategic thinking with a clear-eyed view that we do have major differences when it comes to the two-state solution and the implementation of resolutions on the Palestinian, on an independent, viable Palestinian state. So we're saying where non-communication is not helped, this is the time for communication to help and to, at the same time, to build a viable relationship and make it successful and attractive, which in itself will be a model for many other countries to join us.
How you see the Biden administration policy towards Iran in the Gulf? Are they going back to the JCPOA, or they are going to improve the deal? Can it go together? Isn't the tension there? Or maybe you see a possible escalation?
Well, Iran is a bipartisan issue in the United States. I think both administration, and we heard it very clearly from the new administration, not to allow Iran to become nuclear. We may have different perspective how to reach it, but I was very encouraged hearing the administration during the last hearings that they have, that they are going to have a dialogue with us, with other countries in the region, prior to take a decision. And I think as a good friends share the same interests, we should leave it to discussion, professional discussion in the room with our friends in the United States. I think that's the first point. The second point, definitely, I think the Abrahamic Accord I think increase the regional voice, and I think that's add another weight to the region when we come to a possible solution with the with addressing the Iranian threat, the nuclear region, ballistic, sunset, and the others. So I'm not concerned. I'm not concerned with the American objective, and I think as a friend we should have intimate, transparent, professional dialogue with our friends, and to narrow down if there are some gap and to find the best way, if it's possible through a diplomatic agreement, to prevent Iran for having this capability. We as Israel, you know my opinion, we could not and we should not allow Iran to have a nuclear capability. That's very clear.
Mr. Elzayani, please.
Any new text would have to reflect the new realities in the region and would need to be acceptable to all the countries of the region. And I do emphasize to pursue it in a political and a diplomatic solution. It's very comforting to hear that Biden administration is seriously considering including the GCC and the countries of the region in their consultation. We need to ensure that any new agreement that does not simply postpone the nuclear capability, but takes that prospect off the table.
Thank you. So we conclude with a personal question. Your Excellencies, what most surprised you in your first meeting with Israelis? What is the vision of Israel for Arab state relation in 2030, 10 years from now? And Gabi, what most surprised you when you met your colleagues in the Gulf?
Well, the first meeting I had is with His Highness Sheikh Abdullah bin Zayed. It surprised me that he suggested to meet in Berlin and to go to the from all places to go together to the Holocaust Museum in Berlin. Then I realized that they are very sincere when they talk about supporting modernity, tolerance, and fighting extremism and others. And to see the commitment, you know, after a few hours, I felt like, you know, why we haven't met years before. That was my feeling.
Thank you again for your optimism. Dr. Gargash, please.
When this started, was quite exciting to see. And I was also surprised once we had the Abrahamic Accords of how the Israelis look at the UAE as some sort of very attractive tourist destination. And I think this was something that was quite pleasantly surprising to me. But I think what is more important also is the many anecdotal stories, just like what Minister Ashkenazi said, of people meeting each other in the mall, in a restaurant, in the street, in a hotel. And many Israelis, I would say, have you know, seen many young people in the Gulf, many young people in the UAE, and have seen that people want something different. They want to build bridges. They want to look to the future with positive enthusiasm. And I think all this has been very, very positive.
Thank you. His Excellency, Dr. El-Zayani.
I think the first thing that struck me was the genuine desire for peace with the Israeli leaders, and also the real grasp of details and a quick understanding of the specific areas, in all specific areas. But in the year 2030, I would like to be optimistic. I hope that we look forward or look back and see a region where Bahrain, UAE, and Israel at the center of a peaceful, stable, and thriving Middle East. A Palestinian state that is in peace with Israel, and thriving as its neighbors, and perhaps meeting over a coffee with Gabi and my brother Anwar after 10 years, and looking back on how September 2020 was the month that made all of this possible. That's my vision, and I hope we will achieve it one day.
Shukran. Thank you for your vision. Thank you for being with us. Thank you for sharing with us your insight and wisdom, and for the most interesting conversation that will be broadcast all over the world. I would like also to thank His Majesty Hamad bin Isa Al Khalifa of Bahrain and Crown Prince Mohammed bin Zayed of Abu Dhabi for their bold decisions and important roles in normalizing relations between our countries and our people. Without them, our conversation today would not be possible. I hope that all of you can be with us next year in person, and that your optimistic view, Gabi and you, on the future of the region will be realized in the coming year and those that follow. I also hope that next year you will be joined by additional foreign ministers of countries that will follow suit and sign agreements with Israel. Thank you as well to our audience for being with us today. This ends the first day of the conference. We look forward to seeing you at tomorrow's stimulating sessions. Thank you very much. Shukran.
Thank you.